This channel has now reached over 300,000 subscribers. We're so thankful that this many people are continuing to enjoy what we do here, and that you're all so interested in our natural world and its wonderful history. As has become a bit of a tradition on this channel, to celebrate this incredible milestone, we're going to be exploring what our own planet Earth was like 300,000 years ago, during the Pleistocene, to see the sorts of wondrous non-human animals that were living then, what the climate and geography was like, and which human species were around. As we've done before, we'll start by looking at the non-human animals that were inhabiting our planet at this time, looking at one organism from every continent except Antarctica, to give you a wide overview of what the Earth's fauna was once like. First, Oceania. Australia and its surrounding islands are well known for having once been filled with all kinds of impressive prehistoric animals, and this ancient reptile is no exception. Meet Myolania, a heavily armored turtle relative with imposing horns on its head and spikes at the end of its tail. The genus Myolania includes a few different species, and it is thought to have survived from the mid-Miocene until potentially sometime in the Holocene, so it would have been roaming around Oceania 300,000 years ago. Interestingly, the different species vary quite a bit in their sizes. While the largest bones found so far from Queensland and tentatively refer to the species Myolania platyceps indicate an animal that could probably grow to a carapace length of around 2 meters, species found on islands are much smaller. For example, Myolania mackayi from New Caledonia only had a carapace length of around 70 centimeters, potentially an example of insular dwarfism. As anyone who has looked into the subject before can tell you, I'm speaking from experience here, turtle evolution is complicated. Despite the grouping that Myolania belongs to, Myolaniidae, having once been included within the Cryptidae testudines, the suborder that all tortoises and the majority of living turtles are in, they are actually now classified as stem turtles, meaning they're not closely related to any living lineages. The lifestyle of this ancient stem turtle has actually been the subject of some debate, with some earlier works from the 1920s discussing the fact that certain researchers thought that Myolania was a fully marine taxon that only came ashore to lay eggs, while others believed they were possibly semi-terrestrial shore-living animals that could make short journeys out to sea. Later research then found much more support for the terrestrial hypothesis, but then in 2018 a paper was published which argues that Myolania was actually more sea-based than had been thought, possibly behaving in a comparable way to modern marine iguanas. The armor and spikes along the tail and on the head of Myolania are obviously very impressive, and it's been noted that the tail especially would seem to be an example of convergent evolution with other animals such as glyptodonts and ankylosaurs. The horns on the skull would actually have restricted the stem turtle from withdrawing its head into its shell, but these structures, in addition to the spikes on the bony rings of the tail, were likely very effective defenses against any potential predators. So Myolania is a very worthy addition to the remarkable ancient fauna of Oceania and would have been an incredible organism to see alive. Next, we're travelling across to North America. Like every part of the planet at this time, there were so many fascinating animals living here, but the one we're looking at in this video is the Shasta ground sloth, the genus Nothrotheriops. Although it's not the largest ground sloth that ever lived, the Shasta ground sloth could still reach the size of a bear, and thanks to some remarkably preserved specimens that have been found in certain localities across the continent, we can actually tell quite a lot about what this animal was like. The Nothrotheriops genus lived from about 2.6 million years ago until as recently as 11,000 years ago, having originated from a lineage that crossed into North America from South American relatives during the Great American Biotic Interchange. One of the most remarkable finds of this ground sloth taxon was described in 1929 and comes from a locality in New Mexico, at the site of an extinct volcanic crater inside a natural pit. The specimen was found apparently almost entirely buried in loose bat guano that had accumulated over thousands of years and, incredibly, not only preserved the skeleton of this ancient animal, but also some of its hair and tendons. This utterly amazing find was therefore thought to be an indication that these animals survived until very recently. However, radiocarbon dating of the material has found that it's likely about 11,000 years old, dating this particular specimen to around the time when all the members of the genus went extinct. Other significant discoveries have been made at sites in the Grand Canyon, where more well-preserved skeletons, hair and dung were found. Incredibly, some of this sloth dung apparently still smells quite strongly, even though it's over 11,000 years old. The preservation of dung from the Shasta ground sloth has therefore enabled paleontologists to see what these animals were eating when they were alive, finding that their favourite foods included desert globe mallow, salt bushes, various cacti and yucca such as the Joshua tree. Very interestingly, it's been proposed by researchers that the Joshua tree has actually suffered from the extinction of the Shasta ground sloth, as these mammals were likely a very important seed disperser for the plant. There are examples of sloth dung balls found in Nevada which are almost completely formed of leaf fibers from the Joshua tree, as well as entire seeds, and so the plants would have greatly benefited from the sloth's apparent preference for them. As shown in a paper published in 2011, the inability of the Joshua tree to spread further north, into regions that would be suitable for the species, was likely caused by the extinction of the Shasta ground sloth about 11,000 years ago, making it much more difficult for the seeds of the plants to be transported to higher latitudes. Unfortunately, according to the models generated in the study, the range of the Joshua tree is set to decrease even further, and without the aid of animals such as the ground sloth, they will likely be unable to colonize new areas. So the Shasta ground sloth was another fascinating organism that lived 300,000 years ago, and its extinction 11,000 years ago was a very significant event, the effects of which are still being felt today. After North America, we arrive in Asia. Here, 300,000 years ago, there lived an animal much like some of those that inhabit Asia today, only much, much bigger, the giant tapir. There's not too much to say about this creature, as it's only known from some fairly fragmentary fossil remains, but these specimens have allowed paleontologists to determine that this prehistoric tapir was far larger than the modern ones alive today. Known as Tapirus augustus, though previously being called Megatapirus augustus, this species is known from material indicating that it once inhabited southern China, but reports of its presence have also been made from Java and Vietnam. As well as this, apparently some researchers even claim that it could have survived into the Holocene, only going extinct relatively very recently. The giant tapir was first named and briefly described in 1923, based on a few partially complete skulls from China, and the biggest estimates of the full body size based on measurements of the skull put this mammal at potentially as large as 3.5 meters long and 1.5 meters tall at the shoulder. Absolutely massive for a tapir. Smaller size estimates have also been calculated though, more in the range of just over 2 meters long and about a meter tall. Weight estimates have also been calculated that potentially put this beast at 500 kilograms. The entire skull length is thought to be about 53 centimeters, and something quite noticeable in this image of a fully reconstructed Tapirus augustus skull is the fact that the nasals are set very high up, especially in comparison to the skull anatomy of living tapir species. This has therefore led some reconstructions of the giant tapir to include a particularly giant proboscis as well. So, like many organisms in prehistory, this giant version of an iconic modern animal would have been a brilliant creature to encounter 300,000 years ago. Now we arrive in Europe to look at a particularly intriguing organism, Homo therium, or the scimitar-toothed cat, which lived from about 4 million years to around 12,000 years ago. To be honest, it's a little cheeky of us to say that this is just for the Europe section, considering that the Homo therium genus actually had a massive distribution spreading across several different continents. But it was also found in Europe, so it counts. Fossils of this prehistoric cat have been unearthed in North America too, as well as in Asia and in Africa. However, it appears to have died out in Africa much sooner than anywhere else, around 1.5 million years ago. Remarkably, in 2011, a new species of Homo therium was even reported from a tar seep in northeastern Venezuela, so it was present in South America too at one point. The taxonomic history of the Homo therium genus, as you can probably imagine due to its huge extent, has been quite messy in the past. Many different species in Europe alone were named for various specimens that only showed quite small anatomical differences, and these are now generally accepted to all fall under Homo therium latidens. In the Americas, three different species are recognized, the older H. Ischyrus and the younger H. serum, while the species from Venezuela is known as H. venezuelensis. A study from 2017, however, found that the morphological variation of H. latidens would actually allow H. serum specimens to be included in this species. And genetic data gathered from fossils supports this inclusion too, meaning that potentially all late Pleistocene Homo therium should be classified as H. latidens. The anatomy of the scimitar-toothed cat has been able to inform paleontologists quite a lot about how this beast once hunted and what it looked like, and there's some very interesting aspects to this. Homo therium actually had much longer forelimbs than hind limbs, causing the entire animal's back to slope down towards the tail and giving it an overall posture similar to a hyena. It also had a remarkably short tail, as well as canines that were significantly shorter than the more famous Smilodon. These teeth were still formidable weapons, however, with paleontologists identifying evidence that Homo therium had incredible control over its relatively quite long neck, and was probably delivering canine shear bites in precise areas on the bodies of their prey, causing some serious damage to the unfortunate creatures they targeted. Homo therium was once thought to have become extinct in Eurasia around about 300,000 years ago, while surviving longer in North America. However, the discovery of a mandible from this cat that was dredged up by a fishing vessel in the North Sea led researchers to have to rewrite this interpretation of Homo therium extinction. Radiocarbon dated to just 28,000 years ago, this was later corroborated by genetic analysis, indicating that the genus actually survived in Europe long after 300,000 years ago. Another incredibly impressive prehistoric animal inhabiting much of the globe at this time, Homo therium is a beast you would not have wanted to come across, but is fascinating nevertheless. Next, we're in Africa, where 300,000 years ago there was a wide variety of remarkable creatures living across this continent. The one we're encountering now, though, is an organism called Pelorhovis. This genus was around for a very long time, existing from about 2.5 million years ago through to just 4,000 years ago, and like some of the other animals we've seen, there are a few different species included within it. The history of classification for this beast has been quite interesting, with various different names being given to the taxon since its initial description in 1851, when it was known as Bubalus. Some researchers have also found that maybe some Pelorhovis species should be put within the genus Bos, which includes modern cattle, while other species have been considered members of the Cape Buffalo genus. It also doesn't help that the name Pelorhovis literally means monstrous sheep, when it is in fact a bovine. Today though, it's mostly accepted that this is a distinct genus that is not, as had been suggested, just a long-horned morph of the living Cape Buffalo. Instead, looking at the shape of its horns, differences in the teeth, and the fact that the range of Pelorhovis overlapped significantly with the Cape Buffalo, but that there aren't any intermediate forms in the fossil record, seems to suggest that it is indeed distinct. Pelorhovis was a massive animal, with a possible maximum weight for the largest males of 2,000 kilograms, and potentially measuring about 3 meters in total length, with a height at the withers of about 1.85 meters. This enormous size actually puts the monster sheep, which isn't a sheep, in the running for the biggest bovine that ever lived. In fact, it's even among the largest ruminants to ever exist too, so this was a truly impressive animal. Clearly the most striking feature of these beasts were their incredible horns, which actually varied quite significantly between the different species in the genus. For example, in some species, such as P. oldowayensis, the tips of the horns pointed downwards, whereas in P. antiquus, the tips point upwards and the overall shape of the horns looks more like those of the wild water buffalo, just on a much bigger scale. The length of the horns from the first skull discovered of P. antiquus was estimated at a remarkable 2.4 meters from one end to the other. However, considering that these are only the bony cores which would have been covered by a keratin sheath in life, it's possible that the horns were even larger when these bovines were alive. The enormous size of the horns has therefore also led researchers to consider that these animals were probably inhabitants of open areas with few trees around, as such massive structures on their heads would likely have made navigating dense forests a bit of an issue for them. Another remarkable discovery about Pelorhovis is the fact that there's a great deal of rock art of these creatures across many different localities in northern Africa, meaning that people were interacting with the animals quite a bit, though obviously this art dates to much more recently than 300,000 years ago. Some of the illustrations depict a lot of detail, such as indications of what sex the individuals are, inclusions of dewlaps, grooves on the horns, and other features. A few examples of rock art also show humans alongside these animals in situations that some researchers have interpreted as being hunts, with it being thought that people shown holding axes are perhaps trying to kill these bovines. So there's yet another incredible prehistoric animal that was alive 300,000 years ago. Pelorhovis, the monster sheep, would have been a formidable beast to have encountered at this time, and is another amazing addition to the Earth's ancient fauna. Finally, we're travelling to South America, where we're going to meet a very bizarre animal called Macrauchenia. This genus includes several different species and lived from about 7 million years ago to just between 20 and 10,000 years ago, and fossils have been uncovered in many different South American countries. The first fossils from this genus were actually originally recorded by Charles Darwin himself when, in 1834, the HMS Beagle was surveying a port in Patagonia. Only a few odd bones were recovered, and after sending them to the infamous Richard Owen to be identified, they were named as Macrauchenia, and thought to be from some kind of giant llama or camel-like organism. So what was Macrauchenia? Well, it's actually a member of a very strange lineage of South American mammals known as the Lytopterns, which are themselves members of the larger clade Meridi ungulata, a group composed of several orders of unique South American ungulates that show various degrees of convergent evolution with other mammal clades. A study in 2017 was able to get an almost complete mitochondrial genome from Macrauchenia fossils, discovering that this taxon is actually very closely related to the perissodactyls, the living group including horses, rhinos and tapirs, and therefore Lytopterans are the sister clade to this grouping. The two lineages seem to have diverged from one another around 66 million years ago, just as the non-avian dinosaurs were wiped out, meaning that they had been evolving independently for a very long time. The anatomy of Macrauchenia was particularly interesting, with an overall look that's been compared to that of a camel, but also various characteristics that are very unique. Size estimates for the beast have put this genus at about 3 meters long and a weight of possibly over 1,000 kilograms, so this was a very large animal too. One of the most iconic aspects of Macrauchenia that many people may recognize from seeing reconstructions of the mammal is, of course, the proboscis, which is sometimes shown as similar to that seen in tapirs, and sometimes to that seen in sager antelopes. But how accurate is the presence of this proboscis? Well, it was originally thought to have been there due to the significantly retracted nasal openings on the top of the skull, a feature we came across in a giant tapir earlier and which is also seen in living tapirs, and was interpreted as evidence for Macrauchenia having some form of proboscis as well. However, a paper published in 2018 looked at the skull anatomy of various living and extinct mammalian taxa, finding that the evidence for a proboscis in Macrauchenia was actually not as strong as it had been thought. It was found that the anatomy of the nasal openings are instead more comparable to what's seen in moose than tapirs, leading the researchers to propose that Macrauchenia and its relatives did not possess these elongated structures, and the retracted nasal openings are the way they are for some other reason. These animals were clearly herbivorous creatures, and some interesting studies have actually been done to figure out exactly what they were feeding on. Some older research has found that Macrauchenia was a mixed feeder, meaning it fed on grasses as well as foliage from plants higher up, and a very recent study from 2020 looked at microwear patterns on their teeth, as well as other data, to discover what their dietary habits were like. What they found was that this was a grazing animal that preferred to feed and live in drier, colder regions of South America, while a close relative of the genus fed on similar plants but inhabited warmer areas. There was also an interesting paper from 2013 that looked at the morphological features of Macrauchenia's limbs, proposing that this animal was adapted for swerving behavior since its limb bones were stronger transversely than back to front, something that's seen in modern animals which often swerve as a method of escaping predation. So Macrauchenia was a fascinating ancient beast that ends our look at the non-human fauna of the Earth 300,000 years ago. I hope you've enjoyed learning about these six amazing organisms, and now Ollie is going to explore what the climate and geography of our planet were like at this time.
So, climate. If you have watched the 10,000, 100,000, and 200,000 subscriber specials, you probably know what's coming next. But for those of you who haven't, or for those who have forgotten, let's refresh your memory. We are currently in the Quaternary period that started around 2.5 million years ago. This period is broken up into three epochs, the Pleistocene, Holocene, and the one we are currently in, the Anthropocene, that only started around 70 to 100 years ago, depending upon your definition. The Quaternary period is also broken down into glacial and interglacial periods, as there has been permanent ice on the Earth's surface in the form of Greenland or Antarctica. For the entirety of the Quaternary period, we define this entire period as being an ice age, and we are currently still in one. Glacial periods are what most people think of as ice ages, when there is extensive ice sheets growing and spreading into mainland Europe, North America, and Asia. However, these are just glacial maximums. Ice age refers to when there is at least one permanent ice sheet on the Earth's surface all year round. The last glacial period we experienced was around 11,700 years ago, at the end of the Pleistocene. And when that glacial period ended, so began the Holocene. But what was the Earth's climate like 300,000 years ago? If you remember correctly from the 200,000 subscriber special, 200,000 years ago was the Averley Interglacial. It was quite a clear cut, as 200,000 years ago fell roughly in the center of this rather small interglacial period. 300,000 years ago is not as easy. 300,000 years ago puts us right on the switch between an interglacial going into a glacial. The Holstein, also known as the Mindel-Riss Interglacial, owing to the fact that it is the interglacial between the Mindel and the Riss glacial periods, lasted for around 37,000 years and ended almost exactly 300,000 years ago. This then transitioned into the, you guessed it, Riss glacial period that lasted until the Averley Interglacial started 247,000 years ago. However, it is thought to have continued until 123,000 years ago, as in some areas of the the world, the Averley Interglacial was not that impactful, and some large ice sheets did still remain in some northern areas of Europe and Asia and North America. Really, this is down to definition more than anything else, because it is certainly true that temperatures warmed during the Averley Interglacial, causing glaciers to retreat away from their maximum. However, many of these glaciers survived, and that is why some say the Riss Interglacial period lasted much longer. So what is important to this video is that 300,000 years ago, we were experiencing a shift from an interglacial to a glacial period. This would have had a huge number of effects on the geography of the Earth. When glacial periods approach, the Earth's climate dries out, as huge amounts of moisture and water in the atmosphere freeze and become trapped in the advancing glaciers. So interestingly, the cooling of the climate can actually result in areas around the equator becoming more arid and desert-like. Sea levels would be beginning to drop as glaciers hold vast amounts of water, which would have aided heavily in the migration of early humans as more land bridges fall. Now, the reason for the switch from interglacial to glacial 300,000 years ago, and for that matter every single time it has made the same switch, is still not known for certain. However, there are some very concrete and likely theories. The main theory is the Milankovitch cycles, three cycles that affect the Earth's orbit in relation to the Sun. Eccentricity is a 100,000 year cycle that changes the shape of the Earth's orbit from a more elliptical to a less elliptical, and therefore affecting how close the Earth is to the Sun. The second Milankovitch cycle is obliquity. This is the Earth's tilt, changing between 22.5 and 24.5 degrees over a period of 41,000 years. This has a big impact upon the Earth's seasons, as different hemispheres will get more or less solar radiation due to the tilt. And finally, the last is precession. This is the Earth's natural wobble on its axis. This is around 20,000 year cycle, and again will heavily affect the seasons and climate due to the changes in the amount of solar radiation different areas of the Earth will get. The switches from greenhouse to ice house climates is attributed to the positive feedback loops that are created by the cycles, as the cycle themselves generally have very little impact upon the level of solar radiation reaching the Earth. However, this small variation triggers other bigger variations, at which time it will begin to snowball out of control. Essentially, there is a point of no return, at which point the positive feedback will very, very drastically change the climate, and there is no going back. It is thought that these Milankovitch cycles are what caused glacial periods and interglacial periods, as scientists are unsure what else could possibly affect the climate over such a long time span, as things such as volcanic eruptions, solar flares, and sunspots usually only have effects from a few years to decades, not over hundreds of thousands of years. Now, you may be wondering how we can know all about when glacial and interglacial periods occurred, because they happened so long ago. To determine past climates, we use what are called proxies, essentially different indicators that can be found around the world that tell us the climate in the past. The law of superposition states that the depth at which layers of ice, sediment, or other things are found are directly in relation to its age. This means we can determine how many years ago a certain layer of packed ice or sediment is from. Ice cores multiple kilometers deep are drilled out of the Arctic and Antarctic ice sheet. These ice cores contain layers of dusts, air bubbles, or oxygen isotopes that have been trapped in the ice when it was laid down hundreds of thousands of years ago. And because of the law of superposition, we can roughly know the age of each layer. The amount of dust, air bubbles, and type of oxygen isotope relate to specific climates, so we can see what it was like. The issue with ice cores is that they only allow us to look back around 800,000 years ago, as this is the length of time the oxygen isotopes exist for. The same thing can be done when drilling into ocean, river, or lake sediment. The ratio of oxygen isotope 16 to isotope 18 tells us about the temperature of the ocean at the time, with the more heavy oxygen isotope 18 indicating colder climates, and therefore most likely an ice age. Other proxies like fossil records allow us an insight, as we can see specifically to what kind of climate organisms were adapted to. Tree rings are a common and widely used one as well, where tree growth is determined by the temperature and rainfall at the time, so wider rings indicate more growth, and so more rain and higher temperatures. Smaller rings indicate lower growth, and so colder and drier climates. The issue with tree rings is that you have to cut down the tree, and also the oldest trees are only a few thousand years old at the most. However, it is sometimes possible to use fossilized trees if they are in good enough condition. There's a wide variety of other methods scientists use as well, so there is an enormous amount of different evidence to support all of this. To sum up the answer to the original question, the Earth's climate 300,000 years ago was cold and getting colder, as well as being dry and getting drier. Sea levels were beginning to drop, and the equator and subtropical regions are becoming more arid and desert-like, and all life on Earth is starting to feel effects of this shift.
And now, we move on to me, for arguably the most exciting part of this video. Humans. What were the human species of 300,000 years ago, and what were they doing? Well, let's start off with us, Homo sapiens. What were our ancestors doing? Well, the history of Homo sapiens, especially at this timestamp, is very difficult to unpick, not to mention quite controversial. It used to be believed that the first Homo sapiens emerged into the world about 200,000 years ago, but we keep finding evidence that suggests otherwise, with the earliest fossil evidence found dating past our 300,000 year mark, with most generally agreeing that this is when Homo sapiens likely originated. Of course, this is by no means a complete consensus, with some estimates taking modern humans' start all the way back to 500,000 years ago. The ideas about the back end of the history of Homo sapiens is so interesting and varied, but unfortunately this is because there's so little evidence to go on, and so there are so many interpretations to be made. The 300,000 year old fossil evidence came in the form of parts of a skull, among other things, found in a cave in modern day Morocco. Researchers dated the find to about 315,000 years ago, and it wasn't the only interesting hypothesis to come out of this study. It had previously been thought that Homo sapiens originated in a small area of East Africa, sometimes referred to as the Garden of Eden, but not in the Christian sense. But finding this evidence in Morocco has led researchers to suggest that the emergence of Homo sapiens was on a much larger scale, and eventually encompassed the whole continent of Africa. This is, again, another massive spanner in the works of the whole debate about Homo sapien origins, as the Garden of Eden theory had been a massive part of it. Now, if you thought the disagreements of when Homo sapiens originated was bad, then I'm afraid I've got some worse news when it comes to our famous relatives, Homo neanderthalensis, or Neanderthals. I found the general consensus, however, to be around 400,000 years ago, although this again varies wildly, with estimates ranging from 315,000 years ago and some taking the Neanderthal lineage all the way back to 800,000 years ago. Luckily for us, Neanderthals were around at our 300,000 year mark, and it was around this time that stone tool technology made a shift in the African populations of Neanderthals. The Mousterian industry would come into relatively common use in Europe, Western Asia, and North Africa a couple of 100,000 years later, but this ancient tool-making culture is thought to go back to just over 300,000 years ago. The Mousterian tool-making culture is the name given to a group of several stone tool traditions beginning in the Middle Paleolithic, around 300,000 years ago, and at a time of major cultural and technological advancements, relatively speaking, during the Stone Age, setting Stone Age societies up for the Upper Paleolithic, where we first start to see much more recognisable traits in human species. The famous Levalloy technique used to create heads of stone tools was, among other things, part of the Mousterian industries, but before, this was the dominating technique. By this time, unlike Homo sapiens, Neanderthals had migrated from Africa and had spread across Eurasia. In fact, in the 1930s, a skull was found in Britain dating back 400,000 years, thought to be either an early Neanderthal or pre-Neanderthal. Neanderthals didn't venture out alone, however. The Denisovans had also spread around Eurasia by this time. Not that they were the first human species to migrate from Africa, it's just that they did so at a relatively similar time, we think. You see, the Denisovans were only discovered in 2010, so we know very little about them, as you'll know if you've seen our 200,000 or 100,000 specials. If you want to learn more about Denisovans in general, check out the Denisovan video we made back in April. But for now, what were our elusive relatives doing 300,000 years ago? Well, that's a really tricky question, because we don't even know whether or not they were around. It's believed that Denisovans and Neanderthals had a common ancestor which they split from a few 100,000 years ago, and this yet unknown ancestor split from Homo sapiens' common ancestor quite a bit earlier. Denisovan remains so far have only been found in two separate locations, the first in Denisova Cave in Russia, which they were named after, and secondly the Baeisha Karst Cave in China. This second find shows that Denisovans were a far more widespread species than was thought after the first specimen was found, given the long distance between these finds. This naturally throws up all sorts of questions, namely, if they were so widespread, why have so few of their remains been found? Native Melanesians, Papuans, and Australians have all got a little bit of Denisovan DNA in them, showing that their ancestors likely interbred with Denisovans. Again though, whether they were around or not 300,000 years ago, we don't know for sure. Homo erectus, on the other hand, was around 300,000 years ago, and hundreds of thousands of years before that. Homo erectus was the first human species to look particularly human, with its name meaning upright man. Like many humans on this list, Homo erectus has its fair share of controversies, one of the most prominent of these being whether or not the specimens of Homo erectus found in Africa should instead be attributed to a new species, called Homo ergaster. But despite being the longest lived human species, by our 300,000 year mark, Homo erectus had mostly been surpassed by what is thought by some to be their evolutionary descendant, Homo heidelbergensis, who I'll get onto later. While Homo erectus was a human species that made a great deal of important advancements, being the first to leave Africa, probably being the first to cook food, and the first to use stone axes, this decline that started around our 300,000 year mark eventually led to their extinction about 110,000 years ago. It was relatively recently hypothesized by a paper published in the journal PLOS1 that Homo erectus went extinct due to laziness, as the stones in the tools seemingly used by Homo erectus were of very low quality, and were the stones just found lying around the camp and the immediate area, whereas Homo sapiens and Neanderthals would even climb mountains for some good quality stone. This lack of drive from Homo erectus, coupled with their inability to adapt to the changing climate, is what is thought to have led to their extinction. Moving on now to another one of the oldest human species, Homo heidelbergensis. Homo heidelbergensis is actually an evolutionary ancestor to Neanderthals, but was still around at our 300,000 year mark, with most agreeing that they died out 200,000 to 300,000 years ago. It was the first human species to make the move to live in colder climates, having shorter and wider bodies, which shows us that they were able to conserve body heat more effectively than other human species. Despite this trait, they were exceedingly geographically diverse, living in Africa, Europe, and maybe even modern-day China, as in what is now modern-day China, they're not still there. One specimen found in Africa is Kabwe 1, a skull dating back to our 300,000 years. Found in Zambia in 1921, this specimen was originally attributed to another human species, Homo rhodesiensis, but eventually it was believed that Homo rhodesiensis and Homo heidelbergensis were actually the same species, and so now this specimen is considered to be a specimen of Homo heidelbergensis. Homo heidelbergensis has actually now mostly solved a very controversial debate about Neanderthals, the debate on whether or not Neanderthals were big game hunters and whether or not they used range hunting equipment. Some ancient spears were discovered in the 1990s, known as the Schöningen spears, and these are believed to have been used by Homo heidelbergensis to hunt larger animals like deer, horses, and elephants. As Neanderthals are the descendants of Homo heidelbergensis, this suggests that they too would have used these techniques. And while the mystery isn't solved per se, it has mostly been put to bed by this amazing discovery. It's worth mentioning that there is a theory that Homo heidelbergensis and Homo erectus are actually the same species, or that Homo heidelbergensis is actually a subspecies to Homo erectus. The last human species that I'm going to talk about is Homo naledi, a species that is dated to have lived from 335,000 years ago to just 236,000 years ago, and discovered in 2013. Despite the large number of specimens found of Homo naledi, still not too much is known about what they actually got up to. Interestingly though, they are the least human-like species on our list, and they seem to have been built for more climbing around in trees than sustained running. They clearly had a different diet to other humans living at the time, and it is unknown whether or not they were able to produce any stone tools. However, we do have rather complete skeletons of these particular relatives of ours, and their fingers do seem to be capable of constructing tools. But we just don't have any direct evidence as to whether or not they did it. And that's it. 300,000 years, 300,000 subscribers. Thank you all for supporting us through the last couple of years. It's your support that inspires us to bring out the best content for you, the most entertaining and the most accurate. And thank you especially to our patrons. Without their support, we wouldn't quite be able to reach the quality we do now, and we wouldn't be able to do all the interesting things we've got planned for the future. And I wouldn't have been able to make that documentary on the Spitfire like I did. So thank you. Especially to our dinosaur tier patrons, Jan Owen, Corey Peterson, Greg Silvernail, Afid Kirby, Christian Flores, Just F Max, Amanda von Nordek, Drav Srivastava, Mike Pace, Matthias Bergsier, Persian Boy, Aaron, Mayer's World, George Wojtek, Mark Fawn, Dominic Bathey, Laura Sanborn, and Harry Evett. I've only read out your names twice now, and it's heartwarming to see so many names constantly being added. It always puts a smile on my face when I have to add an extra name to the list when I'm doing 7 days of science. Anyway, thank you to everyone who's even watched one of our videos. We've reached milestones we thought we never would, and yet you keep watching. Fair enough. If you want to hear more from Ben, Ollie, Matt, and myself, check out our sister channels, where we cover anything from history to literature, film and TV, to our own musical compositions. If you've somehow got this far without subscribing, and would like to find out more about our world, its history, and the wonderful life that surrounds us all, please feel free to subscribe to the channel if you think we deserve it, and if you would like to see more from us. Thank you.